I just wanted to share that this weekend, our very first international person in GSM passed away. Yassin Hamdan was a young Palestinian boy that Betty Mitchell met back in, it was the mid 80s sometime. I'm thinking 1986 maybe, but she was on a tour there and met this young boy. And at that time, there was no international work with GSM, but I'm not sure how Yassin got involved in our tour group other than maybe through the Tomb of Lazarus. His family have been the owners and keepers of the Tomb of Lazarus for over 100 years.
Wow.
And so Yassin was a teenager at the time, and Betty Mitchell challenged him to become a Samaritan. And they were at the Inn of the Samaritan, where it's traditionally located there in Israel. And the whole tour group went and they laid hands on Yassin and prayed over him. And Betty challenged him to begin the work of Good Samaritan Ministries in the West Bank in Israel. And Yassin picked it up, and he asked what he was supposed to do. And she said, "You'll figure it out. Ask the Lord and then give me a report when I see you again." And so I think it was a year later, she was back. And wow. Yassin eventually, I don't know what he started that first year, but he brought some others alongside and introduced Betty Mitchell to another man named Majid Alush. And Yassin ended up developing a program for developmentally disabled children. And so they ministered to many, many Palestinian children over the years. And this was a type of service that wasn't available there. You know, so they served a lot of children and helped them have a some semblance of a normal life in a very traumatized neighborhood. And then Majid Alush went on to develop the work of, they call it Al-Sadiq Al-Tayyib, ASTA, which in English translates to Good Friends Association, because over there they can't use the term Samaritan because it's a political term there. It'd be kind of like us saying, you know, we have a Democrat or a Republican group or something like that, which wouldn't be real good. And so anyway, Yassin went on to develop this work, and I'm not sure how old he was, but he's had health concerns for a number of years, but his daughter has taken over, Anwar, who is now going, she's developing a childcare ministry there in Palestine, because so many women can't go to work because there is no childcare. There's no place to take their children. So Anwar is developing that work there. But he had a heart attack on Sunday and went into the hospital, and he died in the ICU. But he has suffered long and hard, and I tell you what, Yassin is getting his reward at this point. He was a man who served God with all of his heart and sacrificed much to do the work that he did. And so I just wanted to let you know that this really is, you know, for those of you that don't know the ministry and haven't been to Israel, when we go, we always go, and some of us usually stay in the home of the Hamdans and Majid's house, but the Hamdans would always host any tour group that Betty brought over there. They would have them for dinner, and so there would be as many as 40 people there on a tour, and they would have all of them in their home for dinner and host the entire thing. Perfect. When we were there. And I've been able to be at the Hamdans a number of times, and my daughter actually got to stay there for about a week one time. So anyway, it's just fascinating. It's interesting, you know, to see the relationship, the significance of Yassine's being the very first international person in the work, and that his death is so close to Betty's. So he and Betty are probably having a party right now. I'm sure they're dancing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But we need to keep the whole Hamdan family in prayer. This is a huge transition for them to have their papa gone.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Does anybody have a book report, life history that you want to share this week before we get started? Or anything else that you need to share before we get started?
How did you guys share the life histories before? Because I wasn't here for that. That was one of the ones that I was behind on.
Okay. So when you share a life history with a class, you do it in a generic sense. In other words, you don't use the person's name. So you might say, I did a history with a 64-year-old woman. And then it's not so much about sharing the details of the person's life as it is about you sharing what you learned and how it was for you to do that. Where would you go with this person if you were going to be counseling them? What might be their diagnosis, which you'd have to guess at. But diagnosis more in terms of what would Jesus do?
Yeah.
Rather than a psychological diagnosis. Mm-hmm. What does this person need? And you may share some details of the history. And okay. It's a time that you can share, that you can ask questions.
I can share a little bit, because while I was on doing other things, I made sure I could do this. But I did it with my best friend, actually. And I realized, because of my writing, I needed to make a new way to document the life history, because I write messy and I have big handwriting. And we only in 2.5 hours got through the first 20 years because there was so much. And it was a lot of praise God moments. But in that, my son actually sat in and listened too, and there were some things that God showed him, that how they are similar and how good God was in both lives and how the enemy meant it for evil. So there's like a testimony alongside of the atmosphere. And even then, I told my friend, I said, Zadok was over visiting her son. I'm like, he does not have to listen or anything like it. We can keep it very private, quiet. She's like, I don't care if he hears. So I'm like, well, that's your choice. So it ended up being a blessing. So I'm not giving the name, although you met her, Cindy, and she would have no problem me telling you that. So it was interesting to see how even from as a child, she was dedicated to the Lord, and how the Lord had even spoken prophetic ministry and healing ministry over her at a young, my dog wants to say hi, I just got home. Sorry. And to see what the enemy tried to steal and how he tried to flip things with a dad passing away and witchcraft and relationships with young men and like just crazy, crazy things, from her stealing vehicles to selling drugs to you name it. She's like, I pretty much did it. Like, she literally did the list of drugs that she used and drugs that she didn't use, drugs that she sold and drugs that she stole. Like, that's, and so it was just very enlightening, because I really tried to just keep on the counselor hat and just listen and write and ask the questions. I went through the book, from the things, the list in Betty's book, in the handbook, the suggest, so that way I could keep it very professional and keep it moving forward in the way you wanted. And it was just interesting to me to literally plot it down and go by grades and go by deaths and go by God's favor and when she got saved, when she met her husband, when God spoke to her. So it wasn't that I was like, oh, there's a diagnosis, because we only got to age 20. and she's a few years younger than me. So we're going to sit down and do more another time. We just haven't had the opportunity to yet. But the thing that I was just amazed at was after I sat and wrote all this out and she communicated about things, she said to me that she had had it prophesied over her that she was going to write a book one day and that she was going to go through her life history, and she's never written it down. And I went, okay. She's like, so when we're all done, can I use it? And I'm like, absolutely. You know, this is God's glory, whatever, all around. So that was kind of interesting, but it was hard sometimes knowing, okay, what's the next question to ask? Because I really try to stay out of the friend mode and to try to stay in the counselor. Like, and so I was trying to listen to Holy Spirit with some of that. And because it was different than I have in the past, that part was challenging for the first time of doing a life history. Maybe you guys have done more, but this was my first one. So I don't know if that gives you the gist of what you were wanting, Cindy, but that's what pretty much I have.
Yeah.
A lot of praise God, God saved out of craziness and literally told her when she was not living for the Lord, the man she was going to marry.
Wow. And so did you learn some things about your best friend that you hadn't known before?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Stuff that we talked about, but never went, oh, it was this year. This is when that happened. Yeah. It was an honor. And that's what I told her. I said, it was an honor to have her share in such a manner that I'm documenting it. And that I'm using that relationship to help me work on how I could facilitate and help somebody else in a different scenario. And so of course we prayed and that Holy Spirit showed up and she was just in tears. She's like, she knew God had been good, but it had never been all these things. Like, if I sat and started pinpointing, there was at least 7 or 8 attacks that the enemy tried to steal what God had intended. And I'm talking major attacks, like mom living for the Lord and then in ministries and stuff. And then all of a sudden moving another guy in and saying that they're married before the Lord, even though they don't have like a marriage certificate, just like crazy stuff that was so off. And from him trying to break into her bedroom and her having a shotgun beside her bed, like, just crazy things, but how God had sustained and how God had brought miracle after miracle into her life and literally broke off all these things that the enemy has meant. And for me, those of you who have heard some of my story, when all the stuff hit the fan in my life and I came and sought counseling through Good Samaritan Ministries and moved to Washington, I moved in with my best friend and she ended up blessing me. And so I told her, I'm like, it blows my mind because she's been such a blessing to me. So anyway, I probably told you too much. Sorry, but that's what it was.
Very good. Thanks, Bliss. Yeah. It is, you know, it's like we at first can be a little intimidated by the thought of sitting down and doing a history with somebody. But I tell you what, it's a blessing. It's a blessing to you and it's a blessing to them, you know, and especially if we can set aside our self-consciousness and just really be able to focus on them. You learn a lot and they learn a lot. And it's interesting that often just in doing the life history, there's healing. Even if you didn't like go back to those exes, those difficult places and do more work, there would be something that would be healed, something that would be brought, there would be some closure for them. Just in doing the history. So good. I'm glad you're going to continue some with her too. That's great. Diane.
It was 2.5 hours. And I know that usually you're like talking an hour and a half, but it took us 20 for just to go through the first 20 years. That's how long it took.
Well, yeah. And I keep a person's life history open the whole time I'm counseling them. I find out sometimes I've been working with them for a year or two and something new comes up. That they never thought of before, you know, but things come out in the Lord's timing and when a person is ready to deal with them. And so it's not even that people necessarily avoid things or that you didn't ask the right questions. It is often just that it wasn't time yet. So I see Diane has her hand raised.
Yeah, I shared a experience I had with life history with our group in Klamath Falls, and Gabe asked me to share it on here. So anyways, back when we first started learning about life histories,
Diane,
it's like, yeah.
Are you able to put your video on, or does it mess up your sound?
Well, I'll try. Our internet here is really bad, so let me try.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
If it goes off, I'll turn it off.
And okay. I just want to say to any of you, if you can turn your videos on, do it. But I understand that sometimes, especially for those of you overseas, it compromises the sound, and you have to turn the video off to be able to talk. So,
yeah, it just makes my cutout really bad. Okay. So anyways, I shared this with our group and Gabe asked me to share it on here. So when we started first learning about life histories, it's like my life history started going through my mind. And a lot of stuff came up that had never come up before, stuff that I had never talked about, never addressed, and it just kept coming up and coming up, and it was getting really, really challenging. I found myself just crying about a lot of stuff, and it was getting really heavy on me. And I even talked to Gabe one night after our group got together, and I said, Gabe, what do we do with all of this stuff when it's coming up? Because I almost felt like it was I wouldn't say a movie, but it was like so real, and it just kept coming up and coming up. And Gabe and I talked about it a little bit. And anyways, it was probably a week or so later that I was sitting down spending time with God, and I really felt like the Holy Spirit prompted me to sit down and physically write a timeline of the Holy Spirit in my life. So I really prayed about it, and I got out a timeline, and I prayed for the Holy Spirit to really reveal to me where he was with me all throughout my life. And it was just so amazing making this timeline. I have a whole timeline of the Holy Spirit, where he intervened in my life, where he was there for me in my life. And it was so powerful. When I was done, I just looked at this timeline of what the Holy Spirit showed me, and it just brought so much healing for me. So, yeah, that's what I wanted to share.
Well, I'm glad that Gabe encouraged you to share that. That's really powerful. You know, and that's a great example of an assignment that the Holy Spirit might lead you to give to somebody, is to do their own timeline, and it might be a spiritual timeline, or you might do a spiritual timeline with a person. You know, you can break timelines into anything you want. I mean, if I'm dealing with somebody, say, who is coming in because of sexual abuse trauma, or some, maybe even sexual addiction or something like that, I'm going to do a very specific timeline just around that subject. If they're coming in for marriage stuff, I'm going to do a timeline specifically on the development of that marriage. You know, so timelines can be very, very focused. You know, you're going to do maybe an overall life history, but then you will do a separate timeline just on the one area, maybe. Or like what Diane did, give them the assignment of doing something of their own. That was really powerful, Diane. Thanks for sharing that. Andrew has his hand raised.
I actually want to ask the questions just regarding the things you just mentioned, timeline. Because my personal experience, I feel lots of people are lying. How to say, mm-hmm. Nature of our life, it's full of lies. So how long I need to take go back to recheck. Is it normally I recheck? Because maybe it's also my conscience is pushing me, double check. Or this is Holy Spirit telling me he's lying or she's lying. So how much things I need to be sure that this is the person is telling the true story. Or for example, usually people, in my experience, people with a sexual abuse experiences, most of them are developed huge potentiality to lie because mm-hmm. they're living with them for a long time, especially when their trauma happened in their childhood. So that's why I'm thinking how to make sure that the person is really opening and how much time I need to spend coming back for that certain issues, but not hurting my, let's say, the person who I'm interviewing. Thank you.
That very good question, Andrew, because people are going to lie, and sometimes intentionally and sometimes not intentionally. Sometimes it's in a sense programmed into us because it's not safe to tell the truth. And especially if you live in an environment where it's never been safe to tell the truth, you may experience some lies. And when an opportunity rises, I will, and I'm kind of maybe suspecting that they're not telling the truth, I will share with them in some way that I will work with whatever they give me. And if they give me lies, then there'll be no healing. Because it is the truth that sets us free. It is the truth that brings healing. And truth hurts sometimes.
Imagine there's an element of shame too.
Absolutely. Shame is a huge perpetrator of lies because we're trying to protect ourselves. And so thus the need to develop safety in the relationship. And so when I'm doing that timeline to start with, you know, I'm gonna stay with some pretty safe topics. Or they may say I was sexually abused, and that's all I'm gonna do. I'm not going to go in depth in that for a while. I might just put it on the timeline, sexually abused, age 3 to 7, or whatever the age range was. And acknowledge that that's really significant and that we will revisit that at some time, but move on to something else. Talk about something else. And of course, you're always praying. And the Lord may give you discernment that they're not being honest with you. And that's where, again, you trust the Lord to show you how to approach that in a way that does not shame them or point a finger or accuse or blame. Because if people are lying, it is often because they are too ashamed to tell the truth, or it's never been safe for them to tell the truth. They're afraid of being judged, of being ridiculed, of being rejected. Lots of reasons that people lie. And sometimes people lie from the womb. You know, they never experienced attachment or bonding to anybody. And so lying is just a way to get what you want. And to tell the truth, and to be honest, people that are in that realm likely won't even come in for counseling because they don't think they need help. Does that help, Andrew? Do you have any other questions about that?
No, thank you. It's a very good insight. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Cindy, in the trauma training that I was gone, that's why I wasn't at classes for my job, one of the things that they talked about was how with the foster care kids, with children that have been abused, there's been major traumas. They talked about that there is a great tendency for them to lie to themselves and others about things. And so for them to even be able to sort it out sometimes takes some healing first. And then they realize that was a perception, that wasn't a fact, or things like that. And I just thought that that would be important to mention in that topic.
Yes, that is very important. When you're in level two, some of what I teach on is how memory stores and how unreliable our memories are. Memories evolve and change over time. They change with our environment. They change with our emotions. Have you ever heard anybody that's told a story and you've heard it more than once, and the second time it was different than the first time? Kathy's pointing to herself. Yeah, you know, and we all do that in some variation, because we may hear input from somebody else and that kind of changes our perspective of our own story. And, you know, there's some things that it's like, I would literally say, well, I absolutely know that I said this or I did that or it happened this way. And then it's like, at this stage in my life, I don't swear by anything. that our memories are very moldable, malleable, changeable, according to the input, the current input or the input that we've had throughout our lives. And trauma memory stores very different than what normal memory. But that's another whole teaching, so I'm not going to go into that right now. But yeah, sometimes the lies come out of just the difference, you know, that really was their perspective. I know, for example, my daughter she swears that she had strep throat every year. And it's like, honey, you never once ever had strep throat. I took you in to get you tested one time. But she will adamantly swear that she had strep throat every year as a kid. It's like, okay, that's your memory, but it's not mine. And I was paying the bills. Okay. Anybody else before we jump into the subject of group dynamics? Let's take a minute here to pray and then we'll head forward again. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for this time together, this evening, this morning, this day, wherever we are around the world. We're just grateful that we can gather, that we can join one another, and that we can learn from each other. Let your spirit flow among us, Lord, and be our teacher. Open our ears, open our eyes to hear what the Spirit would say to us. We just thank you, Lord, that you have called us. You have chosen us, or we wouldn't be here. You chose us. We didn't choose you. And you drew us. You called us. You brought us into this place, and we are very honored, very privileged to be here. So give us your heart and your mind this night, in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so I want to do some participation type thing here. And remember, whenever you talk, go ahead and unmute yourself, but then mute yourself again after you have spoken so that we don't have a lot of background noise and stuff. So I want to talk about group dynamics but first let's go through I want to hear from you some of your experience to share about a group that you have been part of that you didn't like. And what was it that you didn't like? And was there anything in the group that you did like? So when you're ready to share, make sure you unmute yourself so that we can hear you. And then
I was involved in a group that I didn't like. or one of the parts of the group that I didn't like was that there were, out of seven people, there were two people who dominated the conversation, and it wasn't well guided by a leader in terms of having more equal participation. It was hard.
Okay. Okay. So somebody dominating a group and the leader not being able to facilitate the balance in the group. Diane.
I was part of a group once where we would have a certain topic that we would talk about, and people would get off on just all these different kinds of rabbit trails. And I just don't care for that in a group.
Okay, so rabbit trails, not focused, running off in different directions. That's annoying. What else? And I want to use the term group very liberally, you know, small group, big group. Our church is a group. When we're not just talking about a circle of people sitting in a room. There's all kinds of groups.
So I think one thing that comes to my mind is if the group is too large, there's too many participants, I think it allows people, there's either, you know, people who dominate or people who are very reserved and are shy. But I think if it's too big, people are more inclined to not allow themselves to be vulnerable.
Okay.
You know, just because, you know, there's people who are, a lot of people who are introverts. And so I think when the group is smaller, I think the perfect size group is between 7 and 8. And I think it provides more intimacy, and people feel maybe a little more safer. The smaller the groups, the better. So.
Yeah. So different personalities in the groups, you're going to have those that are talkative and those that'll just kind of disappear and you don't even know they're in the group. And the bigger the group is, the more likely that can happen. And you can get a really big group and you will have the same people that speak every time.
Yeah.
And those that don't.
Right. Yeah, definitely.
And speaking of that, who else wants to speak? I know we've all been in groups before.
I was in a couple of groups during my prodigal son years, and I don't really want to identify them at this time because I'm not quite comfortable doing that, but I will say that there are groups that you can be involved with where you don't you don't see the consequences that are coming for certain behaviors, and how it's very easy to get drawn down into concentric circles of trouble, you might say. So I would say that the one factor that is common in that type is the fact that group those groups have a tendency to cling together also. and become very clicky.
Okay.
And there was a time when, you know, they almost, you know, you almost hung around with that group exclusively. And it didn't start out that way, and it didn't, that wasn't the goal, but it just kind of grew tighter and tighter, and you didn't realize it.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's a bad fact of some of these groups, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good point, Mark, that a group can become, especially if you have a closed group and then you don't open it up at some point, that group can become very clicky and dependent on each other, or, you know, kind of an exclusive group situation. Thank you, Mark. Anybody else? Liz.
One of the things is the vulnerability level of trying to make sure everyone feels safe and heard, and that anything shared is not going to go beyond those walls. So sometimes there are people who are able to do that with others and keep things private. And then there are times when it's not safe. And so we're talking, I've done from kids to teenagers, to young adults, to people in their 20s and 30s, to senior pastoring, to like all these different levels of how that different could happen in Bible studies and stuff. And the one thing that I don't like about groups in some situations is that they're afraid to voice a differing opinion than that of the leader. Mm-hmm. And I've always said, I can absolutely completely disagree with you and absolutely love you and adore you and be thankful that you're present and in my group. And that's huge for me, to be able to have somebody feel comfortable to share a differing point of view or opinion than mine. And I'm not saying I'm God, because I'm not, but I will always say, well, here's a scripture, why don't you chew on that and we'll talk about it more. And I'm open to that. Mm-hmm. And just leave it there and not bring condemnation or shame, or you need to be a cookie cutter of what I as a leader think. That's the one issue sometimes there are with groups, is that whoever's facilitating or the leader thinks it has to be cookie cutter opinion. And that's that religious spirit. That's not God. So.
Yeah. So creating safety in groups is imperative. I want to hear from somebody outside the U.S. about your group experience, something that wasn't good.
Yeah, yum.
Ah.
Yes, Stephen Wimbo.
Hi, Stephen.
Hi, Mama. How are you?
I'm good.
I'm with a group here. I want to share with you about the experience I have in the community where I live. So we are in a community where we find ourselves. We are two. We are two types of people speaking one language. We all speak, we communicate to one another, but we are created different. So some group of people are too much segregated. So they don't feel good to associate with others, when especially when we meet in certain functions. like a wedding, parties, someone, he feel like you are offending him or her to sit next to him or her. So even in churches, it happens. A person you speak a same language with, but doesn't feel comfortable to join in with you in a church, yet you praise one God. So it offends some group of people here in my community. So that is what I don't want. Doesn't do good to me. Thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciate that cultural perspective for us. And we have that going on maybe on a different level. But you'll see that with class, with race, with various things that we come into a group with. And I like that you pointed out your weddings and our churches and everything, that there's some of those places that it's very hard for us to create safety. We may not be in control of that, but there is a cultural aspect of where I feel safe and where I don't. And so when we are leading small groups ourselves, and we have people coming in from a variety of cultures, that's something we need to be really sensitive to and make a deliberate, maybe some deliberate things to help alleviate the cultural stigma, the discomfort, that will help bring safety to a small group. Yeah. Thank you, Stephen. Appreciate that.
Welcome, Mama.
Babiri's group has a hand raised.
Yes, Mama, we greet you all in the name of Jesus. Happy New Year. Yes, and I'm with my group here. And what I really didn't like about the group I was in is the disagreements and arguments, whereby you could talk about something and you end up as seeing, observing everyone wants to be right. So that came to the point that we ended up disagreeing with each other. So due to the cause that everyone wanted to be right, you know, we ended up splitting what, so that was what I didn't like.
Thank you. That's a great example of a group experience that isn't safe, where it's not safe for me to have an opinion, and the need to be right. So we'll talk a little more about this later. Thank you. Okay, we have a couple other hands up here. And I see Hannah on the screen.
Yes. It's Jessica, her daughter.
Hi, Jessica.
Hello. So we're talking about groups. I appreciate groups because when you're in groups, you understand that you don't have to go through everything alone. It's like having another kind of family, being with other people, hearing other experiences. And sometimes when you're in a group, you understand that sometimes your voice is heard, and when you're in a group, your voice is always heard and recognized.
Can you Can you move closer to the speaker?
I understand that when you're in a group, most people fear to speak when they are face to face with a person, like two people. So when you're a group, you have this sort of safety you feel because you are with other people. Mm-hmm. Yes, that is how I feel when I'm in a group.
Very good, thank you. Let's see, there was Nakayumi.
Hello.
Hello.
This is real.
Uh-huh.
I had the experience with the group I didn't like. I joined it when I didn't know that the leader was a bully, and she used to bully us, and we had no option to do so. I used to feel bad. I was a newcomer, so you had no option. But eventually I left it. And also I joined the group when in a group they selected us in a group of 10, but we had to work together and people were making small groups in their group. So we had no, like, you making 3, 2, 1, and then you stay alone. So you have to just keep quiet and just listen to what they say. Thank you.
Uh-huh. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. So yeah, a bully in the group, that makes the group not safe, right? Okay. Anybody else? Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, so one thing that I think is really valuable in the group is when people start sharing their experiences and they're in their process, and there might be another person in the group that has experienced the same thing. And so I think when that happens, you start developing commonalities with amongst the group members, and that's when the connections start building. You know, mm-hmm. like, well, I experienced that exact same thing, or I went through that as well, you know? And so, I think that's kind of the glue that holds the group, is just, you know, making those connections with other people by sharing similar experiences. Yeah,
I can't remember whether it was Jessica or Real that one of you said something similar, you know, that it becomes a family. It can become that functional family that maybe we don't get to experience in our regular life.
And especially too, if you were raised in a family where you weren't allowed to share certain things, you know, because I mean, that's how your parents role modeled to you, to the children, that you know, we don't share certain things about our family. And so then you grow up as an adult, and it's hard for you to do that. And then when you're in a group of people and you're there for the same reason, then I think it allows those certain group members that, you know, it was a learned behavior in their family, I think it makes them feel a lot more heard and accepted.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's a really important point, that groups can be a source of breaking down those cultural barriers, the family, and by culture, I'm speaking pretty broad. I'm not saying just nations, but our families have a culture, our communities have a culture. But those things that are programmed into us, that thou shalt not, thou shalt not share the family secrets. And some cultures are much more deeply ingrained in that as a whole than others. So at GSM, and those of you in Uganda and in Mongolia can probably relate to a very deep cultural shame, that there's many things that It's just, you just don't talk about those things. And so in a sense, those of you who are choosing to become counselors and leading groups and stuff, you're really breaking some barriers and bringing a new depth of safety to people where they can be who they are. They can speak what's in their hearts and they can heal. So yeah, and as I looked through, I kind of wrote down some of the things that you were saying along the way here, and one of the common threads that makes a group not comfortable or something that you didn't like about it, in some way you were saying the group wasn't safe. It was being dominated. It wasn't well facilitated. The leader maybe sat back and kind of lost control of the group. Too many participants, and it makes it not safe to be vulnerable. Varying personalities and being able to balance those personalities. We'll talk more about that later. We can develop cliques in groups, even, you know, a group within a group. There might be, you know, some side talk going on over here, and these two people are friends, and these three are friends over here. And so there gets to be some cliques and competition in the group. I liked what you said about the cultural stigma, that the lack of safety that creates that we come into a group and it may be a different social status, a different language, a different, maybe we just live on different sides of the track. And so I come in with an expectation that I'm going to be rejected, or somebody else comes in with an expectation that they're going to be honored and respected. So creating balance. A need to be right. Boy, that can be a real group buster. But and getting into arguments and disagreements in a group can just kill it. So lots of things that you shared here that are really relevant. And I think it's important that we understand the things that aren't good, aren't safe in the group, as we then work towards, okay, how do we facilitate a safe group? And I wanted to talk a little bit about the groups that Jesus led. Jesus, there are open groups and there are closed groups. And by that, I'm sure most of you understand what that means, but an open group is anybody can come. You don't have to sign up. There's no registration. People can come and go. They might be here 1 week and not the next. And then there are closed groups, and closed groups are typically more of a therapy type group where we have a closed in. It might be a 6 week or 8 week or 10 week course that we're taking. And so the group is closed because the one session builds on the next. And so the information would be cumulative, but also it might be closed because we want to develop trust in the group. And so we keep a limited number of people that can come into that group, but it's very important with a closed group that there be an end to it and that group be able to open up at some time, or maybe you run a 10-week cycle, you take a couple of weeks off, and then you run another cycle of the group. So let's look at some of Jesus's groups and just think about, were these open or were they closed groups? So Jesus, he had the 12 disciples. That was an obvious group. Was that open or closed?
I'd say both, because it was come and follow me. And if they came and followed, they became part of the bigger disciple group. But then there was those that were the more intimate.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say it was open, but by people's actions and their seriousness, kind of affected where they fit in that. Does that make sense?
Yeah, only I would look at it more as the 12 was a closed group. He chose the 12. And even within the 12, there was another closed group. There was the circle within a circle, you know, so he had the 12 disciples that he would often pull aside away from the larger crowd. And he lived with them 24/7. But there was still an end date to this group of 12 that Jesus was with them for 3 years. And, you know, that's a pretty long group, but because of the task that lay ahead of them, they needed 3 years of this intimacy with Jesus. And then within that group, you saw an inner circle of how Jesus would pull Peter, James, and John aside. And that the three of them would show up at various things that the rest of the disciples, in some sense, weren't invited to. Like the Mount of Transfiguration, for one. And so we'll often see that in groups, that there might be a bigger circle of a group and then a smaller, more intimate group within a group. And so I would look at the group within the group as people who are being more closely mentored by the leader, whoever that is. Jesus also had small and large crowds. And as we go through the healing miracles, you've probably noticed that anytime Jesus is ministering to one, you know, one person may be the object of a healing. But one of the things that we see in studying the healing miracles is that there is always everybody there is affected. That there's probably a lot more healings that go around in the crowd at various levels when someone, you know, it's like Jesus touched this person and they were healed of leprosy, or they were delivered from demons, or they were set free from something. But there were also people in the crowd that may have been delivered from something or healed of something themselves, whether it was physical or mental or emotional or psychological or spiritual. You can bet that every single person in those healing were, in all of those groups, were touched in some way. So large groups, you know, Mount of Beatitudes, the loaves and fishes. He often taught on the shore of Galilee. He was in the temples and the synagogues. So these are open groups. Whoever shows up is part of the group. And then portions of these same larger groups, you could say Jesus had groups on the move. He was constantly teaching experientially. Everything in his life was teaching the people that were with him. There was usually the group of the 12 disciples around him, but then there were also those that traveled with them and were part of the disciples, but just not the inner 12. And so Jesus, you know, we hold groups in a variety of places. Where are some of the places that Jesus held groups? And anybody can jump in.
Up on a hilltop.
On a hilltop, yeah, where he could use it as an amphitheater, maybe.
I had a question. With a lot of these groups that you mentioned, the different sermons and the healings that are here and there, those are really more of an event gathering, because he was here doing this miracle, or he was mm-hmm. there doing this or that. And I absolutely think that aside from the person who was healed, there was people who were affected throughout the crowd, and later mm-hmm. on, as they maybe went back home and thought about it and talked to each other and shared experiences. But maybe it's just a matter of the language, but it's not really, I mean, to me, it's like I said, that's an event. It's not really an 8-week course that he does for the apostles, absolutely. But I'm trying to figure out how is that classified in terms of group therapy?
Okay, so we're not necessarily talking about group therapy. We're talking about groups and leading groups. Okay. And so a real variety of, you know, we have a real variety of groups. And that's what I'm looking at right now is the variety of groups that Jesus led. They weren't all therapy groups. They weren't all teaching groups. Some of them were weddings and various other groups that Jesus was in that he either taught, led, or influenced in some way.
I guess I was just jumping the gun a little bit there with.
Yeah, good question, Mark. That's fine. That's good. And so he taught out in the open. Where else did Jesus teach and lead groups?
Well, one of my favorites is the one where he actually didn't show up, which is when he told them to go wait in the upper room. And then Jesus wasn't the one that was doing the teaching or the affecting. He was allowing them to experience the next level. And
okay.
Then he obviously returns and walks and they see him and doubting Thomas sees the hands and all of that, all these crazy, amazing things that Jesus had done, but he had actually said to them, go and wait. Mm-hmm. And he wasn't even going to be in that group.
Yeah. And so that there's locations like that, the upper room, various buildings where they actually arranged a meeting like what we do today. What are some other places he had groups?
On a boat,
yeah.
In people's personal homes.
Yes, in people's homes there was where he healed Peter's mother. He told Zacchaeus, I'm coming to your home to have dinner. He goes to the home of Simon the Pharisee. So there's a number of examples of home groups.
He goes to the tombs when he raises Lazarus from the dead, as well as when he arrives on the shore and the demoniacs are set free.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In Capernaum, where they brought a guy from the roof.
Yeah, so was that Peter's mother's house, I think? Yeah.
Maybe. Yeah, big group there, yeah.
Yeah. And there were times that it said that he would draw his disciples away and go to a quiet place to rest. So he would deliberately take them out of the fray and try to escape the larger crowds just to have that intimacy with his inner circles. And he taught in the synagogues and the temples.
Gardens, like Garden of Gethsemane and stuff like that, obviously.
So he had a lot of outdoor locations. And so you see, we're not that much different today. We teach in our churches and in various buildings. We teach in outdoor locations, or we gather groups in these various locations. So let's talk a little bit about the purpose of the groups that Jesus had. One of the things I love about Jesus is that his love, the kingdom of God, was demonstrated, not dictated. He wasn't there to just tell you about something. He wasn't there to just talk about the kingdom of God or teach about the kingdom of God. He was there to live it and to demonstrate it. So Jesus was a very experiential leader. And no matter where he went or what kind of size or type of group he was in, he was always demonstrating the kingdom of God. So in a sense, always teaching the gospel of relationship, mercy, grace, forgiveness and reconciliation. And the other thing I love is that it was always safe. People could be just as screwed up as they were. They could have doubts and fears and questions. And he was always safe. And interesting, you know, that even though sometimes the groups were massive, 5,000 and more, Jesus always taught to the individual. And I'm not saying that he picked one person out and taught that person. Sometimes he would, but even in that, even if he was healing or speaking to one individual, it was still a message to the hearts and the spirits of every single individual in that group. And that's why today, you know, we can all read the same passage in the Bible, and every one of us will get something different out of it according to our needs. And we see that a lot when we're acting out the healing miracles, is we play the different parts and we see how differently that miracle affected each and every person that was present. What would you have to say about the purpose of the groups that Jesus was leading? Or maybe observations.
He had the interest to know people as he wanted people also to know him, to know the love of his Father and why he came. That he was there for them and for them to benefit, yes.
So it was always relational.
Yes.
And I think, you know, this is something that we talk about when we'll be doing the teacher training a little bit later in the spring, is how critical relationship is in leadership. And that Jesus had relationship with everybody that was there. He saw them as individuals. And it's and we've all experienced this, where you've maybe been in a group where there's been a speaker or a teacher or a leader, might be in church, it might be something else, but how you can listen to somebody and it's just words. And I know I've sat through messages sometimes and gone, man, it's really solid scripturally. It's just, you know, the message is right on. The content is great. But the speaker didn't know how to have relationship with the people he was speaking to or she was speaking to. And you can feel the difference. And the difference is that you can teach a subject or you can teach a person. And so in a good group, we will be teaching the people and the people will be teaching each other and the teacher will be among us. It's not one person, it is the group itself and the Holy Spirit among us that is teaching. And one of the other things I love in watching Jesus is he always maintained authority. Kind, loving, compassionate authority. He spoke the truth in love. So sometimes he spoke really hard things, but it was always in love. And it was always for the welfare, the benefit, the healing of whoever was there, of everybody. You know, we sometimes think that he was, that maybe he didn't like the Pharisees or the scribes, but he loved them just as passionately as he did the sinners and those who followed him. And that's why he spoke the truth to them. And it was hard because he confronted their religiosity. But he did it with great love. And some of them received it and some did not.
I would also say a big thing was he had different ages, because obviously there are times when we know we interact with children, and he even said, let the little children come to me. But not only that, different from it being someone that was a prostitute or assumed to be, to people who were in leadership, to tax collector, like he had no barriers culturally nor socially, like, oh, this is the upper, I forget what they call that when it's different groupings, but yeah, he didn't have that. He loved them and showed them the same kind of teaching, no matter who or what they did or any of that.
Yeah, I love that you brought that out, Bliss, because it's like he often shocked them with the people that he would include or the people that he went to, like the woman at the well. Like the woman caught in adultery and the tax gatherers. He would shock them. I'm going to a tax collector's home for dinner. And then he'd go to a Pharisee's home. And then he'd go to the home of a fisherman.
He sat and talked to Nicodemus in the middle of the night, like later in the evening, like all those kind of things. He didn't have barriers.
Yeah. And also he went to Martha and Mary's house.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know. So.
Yeah. So any other comments or thoughts on the groups that Jesus led before we move into what we do today?
I think, to Hannah's group, Jessica, I think Jesus was in groups I think he was in groups to show them how to behave, like show them their way of life. Like there is a place where they were going to beat up a woman with stones. And then he said that if you have never done something wrong, if you're standing here and you are as pure as can be, then throw the stone, and everyone put down that stone. That shows that every group that he was in, he made sure to show them how to be. Yes.
Yes. Yes, Jessica. He taught. This is what we call experiential teaching. He would teach by demonstration and by experience and assignments. He gave them assignment. If you don't have any sin, go ahead and throw a rock. Yeah. Thank you, Jessica. Any other thoughts or comments?
This is Stephen. I see Jesus meeting a woman at the well. So it teaches me that he was strategic enough and positioned himself in a place where he could manage to attract the city, the whole city, coming to him through one person, the woman he met at the well.
Yes. Osborne just gave a fantastic teaching on this in our level 2-3 class a couple weeks ago. Mm-hmm. A great example of Jesus crossing those cultural barriers. He's in the middle of not only Samaritans, but a Samaritan woman. Mm-hmm. And a woman who was with a bad reputation. Mm. Yeah. He broke all the rules.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, Stephen.
Welcome.
Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the types of groups that we have today and jump in and throw in any other types that I don't mention or that you can think of, because I'm just going to kind of give an overview or some examples. In counseling or in leadership, in ministry, we have a lot of different types of groups. And so there can be very specific counseling groups. And so they are groups that are intended to for growth, for healing, maybe for prevention, to help teach people skills to prevent certain problems in our lives. It might be, you know, a counseling group. Of course, this is a counseling group that we're in here, and we're here to learn some very specific the dynamics of counseling, and to share the how-tos and how-to nots, and teach help. So it's a growth group. It's a developmental group. And I would hope that you are developing a sense of self-awareness, where you're looking at, you know, where am I in this process? What do I know? What do I need to know? And just creating that hunger to learn more and to keep growing. So counseling groups can be any number of, you know, like this, we cover a lot of subjects, but all of them are counseling related or ministry related in some way. Therapy groups are more specific. And so a therapy group is probably going to be focused on maybe a specific type of, like we might have a therapy group that focuses on dealing with depression and anxiety. We offer here at Good Samaritan Ministries a therapy group called Dialectical Behavioral Therapy, and DBT. And this is a group that is, our group is actually more instructional than therapeutic, because therapeutic groups will be the type where people are sharing their personal experiences and things that they struggle with, and then maybe practicing some skills in the group. Our DBT group here at Good Samaritan Ministries is primarily skills group, and so it's not as much therapeutic in that you don't have a lot of sharing of your personal things. You just have, let's learn and practice this skill. Okay. Other therapy groups might be, and if you have a DBT group that is a therapy group, it's going to be working more on personality reconstruction, on helping you confront those things in yourself that you need to change. And that's often what a therapy group is about. Any comments on that? Maybe some of you have experienced therapy groups or facilitated therapy groups of some type.
I was an addiction counselor, and I ran many groups. So it was, you know, targeted towards, you know, addiction, relapse, and recovery. So I've seen mm-hmm. some interesting groups. Yeah.
Yeah. So they're more focused, structured type of groups, yes. huh? Yeah.
Absolutely. Yep. And people share very personal things. And lots of emotion comes with that.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah. They're very intense. Yeah.
We also have anger management group here. And yeah. that group is often very much sharing from your personal lives. And, you know, there's not a real fine line between these different types of groups. Some of them are kind of crossover that a structured support group often ends up being kind of a therapy in some sense. We have a group here on Wednesday mornings that we just call it the life-giving group. And so there's not like one focus for any certain malady or anything. It is just a group where you can come and share whatever's going on in your life and whatever you need support for. But there's also support groups that center around very specifics. Like you might have a grief and loss support group. That could be a closed group that meets for a certain amount of time to process grief and to learn some skills for walking through the grieving process. You can find lots of structured support groups around pretty much any kind of disease or malady. You know, there's support groups for cancer, there's support groups for MS. I mean, we could go on with any number of groups. And if there's not a group and you see a need for one, you can create one. But there's all kinds of support groups out there that are very, very helpful. I've been in and seen helps facilitate groups for people who have very specific losses, like the death of a child or suicide or something like that, where the people in the group have a very common a connection around one specific type of loss that they've had. Bliss.
I was a part of a chronic support group, meaning for chronic pain. And in that, they talked about our physical bodies and how to take better care of them, our mental, emotional well-being and relationships, and our spiritual as well. So it was phenomenal because I had never taken some kind of, or been in support group for grief. I've done all those kind of things, but one that literally brought all the aspects of my life into check, which was my health, my mental health, my spiritual health, my relational health. Like, it was just so good. And so I loved and enjoyed that. It was probably out of all the groups that I've been a part of, especially support and even Bible studies. I'll be honest, I think that was probably my favorite because it was practical. It was easy to enact and to try new things that would help. And there was lots of good solutions. So anyway.
Yeah, great example. And then we have, I guess you could term them self-help groups, but our support groups. We, of course, there's the AA, Al-Anon. They don't necessarily have a professional trained leader. It may be somebody that's been through the group and then takes over as a facilitator. And so you've got groups where that are facilitated groups, like there's some really great parenting programs and marriage programs and stuff like that. And they have workbooks and they have a facilitator's manual and stuff like that. So the person, I think that's really a great way to begin leading a group if you've never led one, is you lead one that has already been laid out for you. And you just facilitate the material and the conversations of the people and the interaction. And then you can move into more of the type of group where you are actually creating content and teaching. yourself. But there's some great ways to break into beginning to be a group leader if you've never done it before. Of course, for us, we've probably pretty much everybody here has been in some type of a Bible study group or a faith-based group at some point. And we all know that those can be led by pastors and trained professionals, but we can also start a facilitated group with, again, material that's been created by somebody else, or just taking a book and going through that book together, a Bible study where you just get together and read the scriptures and talk about it. So lots of different personal growth type groups like that. You see some general groups out there like book clubs, where it's just, where it's more of a social gathering. It's not like you're getting together to grow and share your problems or anything like that, but you get together with a common interest. Like you all read the same book and then you get together and talk about it and drink wine or something. And then of course, all of our, there's lots of different hobbies. You can get together with people for groups to learn how to do different crafts and skills and all kinds of fun things. And if you have some type of an exercise group, athletics, those are all groups. I mean, you think of athletics and how some teams do really well and others don't. And a lot of it has to do with the coaches, has to do with the leader. How does this person lead and what is their relationship with the team members? So that's just kind of an overview of some examples of types of groups. Does anybody have another idea or group that you would throw out there?
I would say like exercise groups, people who are trying to lose weight loss groups, people who are fighting diabetes. Like there's so many different kinds like that too, to help the self-betterment kind of groups.
Yep. And so, and there's different styles of leadership too. And that's not, and there's no like one right way to do it. There are, I think it requires different styles for whatever type of group that you are in. There's the authoritarian, where the leader of the group determines the policies. And so the leader comes in, they say, here's what we're doing. Here's the schedule. This is the way we're going to function. And they may even set guidelines for group interaction and stuff like that. And so that is more of an authoritarian type of leadership. And I can say that's kind of what this class is, that I am in an authoritarian position in that I determine the schedule, I determine the topics, I lay things out, but I also like to keep it relational in a sense, the democratic, where everybody gets a voice, everybody gets to speak, that there's opportunity there. But still, there's one person basically that is in authority over the group and sets the schedule and tells you when to come class and when it's going to end and those type of things. Then there's what they call laissez-faire. And I don't know if anybody can think of an example where they've seen this really work. Leader participates very little. They just kind of sit back and let the group run itself. Has anybody had experience with this type of leadership where it's actually worked?
Not working, but I've seen it in what they call laissez-faire parenting style.
Yeah, that doesn't sound very effective. No. Laissez-faire groups, it's interesting when you sit back and let the group develop itself, that a leader will come forth. that the group won't stay with equal input, that there will be somebody that has a voice that ends up kind of coordinating and facilitating the group at some point. And so, you know, this type of a group might be one that you would do to just, in the end, help people talk about the about group development. What transpired here? How did this happen? And the different roles that the people in the group take on as a result of a laissez-faire type of leadership that just kind of says, have at it. What do you want to talk about? There is the democratic style of leadership, and that's where the policy is set by the group, aided by the leader. And so I like to do that in terms of often when I start a group, I will have the group talk about, okay, what would you like to have as boundaries or rules for this group? There's some of them that for me are no compromise, that we are going to have confidentiality in this group. But usually if I sit back and I ask the group to come up with some group rules or guidelines, that's one of them that will always come up, is confidentiality. That what we talk about here about our personal lives stays here. Now you can take the content of the material we teach and share it with anybody. But if somebody shares a personal story, that stays here. And so we have an agreement of confidentiality among the group. It's not as, it's a little different doing this online. I mean, because if we're in a big circle, there's probably going to be more rules around group safety and side talking and interrupting and one person at a time and, you know, lots of things to help create group safety. And so anyway, the democratic style of leadership, the group has a pretty strong voice in the direction of the group. And then the fourth one would be co-leadership. And that's where you have two people leading a class. Vonda Winkler and I co-led a trauma healing group that we started in September this year, or October, whenever it was we started. And that's where you have two people that work together. And so Vonda and I have known each other for many years, and we just kind of dovetail off of each other and can plug into what the other one's teaching on, because we've both had a lot of training in trauma. And so it's often a good way to, again, if you've never led a group, to do it with a co-leader or a co-facilitator and somebody that is maybe kind of a mentor with you. And you take turns, you decide who's going to teach what or who's going to lead which part, and work together as a team in leadership. And by the way, I should have said this, I will send this entire outline to you, so you'll have all of this information, but it's always good to write things if you're taking notes, that helps you remember it too. But I thought this was in the manual, and I looked this morning and found out it wasn't, because Teresa taught last year, and so I didn't have this material in there.
Some of it was in chapter 8, but some of it isn't.
Yeah. But I will send this out to you email probably tomorrow. So basic styles of leadership. And then in our conversations earlier, the group roles was brought up, that we all kind of default according to our personality to a role within a group. And so this is the challenge. This is where leadership is challenged. How do I balance all of these different personalities? And what are the challenges of some? So I'm going to go down through a list of about 8 different types of roles or personalities that you might find in a group. And maybe we can identify some of the challenges and also the benefits of the various roles. So you've always got the energizer. And what's the energizer's personality going to be like? For one thing, they provide enthusiasm. But what else? What is good or what might be challenging about having the energizer in your group?
Too much laughter.
Yeah. They can kind of sidetrack the group.
They may want to motivate the group to maybe, I don't know, share more.
Uh-huh. Any other thoughts on the energizer?
They can also keep it fun, so you want to go and have some laughter and enjoy while you're accomplishing whatever the group's purpose is.
Yeah, and the energizer, the challenge with the energizer is often they might be one who's going to kind of take over the group and might head it in a direction that you hadn't planned for the group. And so you sometimes kind of need to learn how to keep a handle on the energizer, how to be tactful in saying, okay, so let's hear from some of the other people in the group. I want to hear from some voices that I haven't heard yet today.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They also might do that as a deflection.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so then kind of on the polar opposite of the energizer, you have the follower who's going to go along with everything and agree with anything that others say in the group. And so in a sense, they don't have a voice. And so the person that you might identify as the follower in the group, that's in a sense a yes man, you know, just going to agree with everything, that might be the person you're going to encourage to speak. You might call on them to speak up before others speak. You might make, you know, sometimes you will just go random in a group. Okay, anybody speak whenever you want. And that's kind of what we do here. But there are times when it's appropriate to say, okay, we're going to start with you, Jane, and let's go around the group. And so you might deliberately start with the follower to help them have a voice.
Would you normally wait to do that till you have a little bit of a working relationship so they feel safe so that way they will share opinion?
Yeah, and that's going to develop kind of naturally because you're not going to even know what the roles are until you've met a few times. It's going to take the leader a while to pick up on the fact that, oh, this one is a follower. She doesn't have a voice. And so that would kind of unfold naturally. You can end up with a scapegoat in a group. And this, if the group is not safe, the scapegoat is going to be the one who is blamed for things. Or others, the group, somebody in the group will start talking about them behind their back. And it's like, oh, geez, so-and-so showed up today. I wish they weren't here, you know? And so this is one reason and this is where it is imperative that the leader know how to create safety in a group and to shut down criticism, blame, shame. And well, all of you know here my motto of no fixing, no saving. I'm going to add in no advising and no setting each other straight. That those are my group rules. And I, regardless of what kind of group I'm leading, no fixing, no saving, no advising. Oh, well, let me tell you what you need to do. And contrary to most people's belief, a counselor is not an advisor. A counselor is a listener. And that we are here to help people discover what they need to know. We're not here to give them advice and tell them what we think they need to be doing. So no fixing, no saving, no advising, and no setting each other straight. That's a good, those are good guidelines to keep a group safe. And so as a leader, you're going to need to learn how do I redirect when I see the group moving towards a place that isn't safe. Another person that might not be real safe is an interrogator. This is somebody who asks questions that are not for the welfare of the person that's being asked. And so they may be asking questions out of their own curiosity. You know, that a lot of people have a morbid curiosity of, oh, I just want to know more. I want to know more of the key details or whatever. Or they may be interrogating or asking questions in a judgmental way that is accusatory or shaming or blaming in some way. And so as a group leader, how are you going to handle this? How are you going to help back that person off? And this is one of the reasons I love to set the group standards or rules right in the beginning, because you can always go back to, okay, let's back up just a minute here. We want to create safety for this person. And so let's just listen to her rather than grilling her or interrogating. You know, so whenever you bring correction, you want to bring it in a way that doesn't shame, because often the interrogator doesn't even know that that's what they're doing because they're so used to it. It's what they've known. Maybe they've been interrogated themselves.
Would you say the interrogator that comes from a mindset of their own insecurity?
Possibly.
Take other people down, so to speak?
Yeah, you know, I think it could be from a variety of things. It might be from their insecurity, that need to control. Maybe the need to be important. I have the answers. But anytime that you have the slightest sense that somebody is being threatened or humiliated or shamed in any way, you as a group leader, that's when you start, you're praying, Lord, help me. How do I shut this down? What do I say that will minister to both of the people? The one being interrogated, make it safe for them. And the one that's doing the interrogating, to learn that they're creating a safe, an unsafe space for this, for the whole group, really. Because you can feel the whole group squirming when the safety starts going out the window.
What about
back to the no advising, what if somebody specifically asks for advice on something?
Well, that could be an exception. It depends on the type of group. And again, as a group leader, you're going to have to use your own judgment or perspective in that situation too, that is this person, is it better to give them advice or is it better to ask them questions that help them discover what they need, which is typically the answer. Because when we begin giving advice, telling somebody what to do or how to think, or you should or you shouldn't, what are they going to learn from that? And in the types of groups that I'm used to leading, they're typically groups where people are, they're wanting to grow, they're wanting to change, they're wanting to find answers. So does that help?
Yes, that helps a lot. Thank you.
Okay. A gatekeeper. Their job is to make sure everyone talks, and the gatekeeper often wants to run the group, but they often don't deal with their own issues. And so, again, the leader has to learn how to tactfully bring the group back and help the gatekeeper be one of the group, rather than taking, they want to take over the leadership of the group and probably are thinking that you're not facilitating the group, right? And maybe you're not. Maybe there does need to be some help in spreading it out, but it's one to keep your eye open for. Any comments on that one? Bliss, did you have a comment on one of them or on this one?
On the other one, actually, because like when we did our first life histories, like when we broke up into small groups, it felt like, in a sense, kind of like we were interrogating each other, like asking these quick questions and not really getting to delve into anything. It felt really awkward. Uh-huh. And it was like, okay, what should I ask next? Like that pressure. And I didn't like that personally, because it felt like I should know where that was going, instead of like being able to be a little bit more time sensitive with Holy Spirit speaking, right? Like, so I don't know if that was anybody else's experience, but like when we did that breakout session, that first one, mm-hmm. if you remember the one I'm talking about, like that's how I felt, like pressured to have to ask questions. And mm-hmm. also when others asked of me, like it was like rapid fire, mm-hmm. right?
Well, that's why we call it practice. And you're going to experience some of that in this class, because you are being put on the spot sometimes, and you are learning new skills, and you're not going to be comfortable with doing it when you first start out. And you're going to have people of varying skill levels and the different roles or capacities of the people that are in the group. This is one of the challenges that I do have with practicing on Zoom, is because you need to go in the breakout rooms. You need to be able to experience smaller, more intimate groups and be able to practice. And I can't be in those breakout groups. You know, I can go into one here or one there, but this is where you begin now using this type of information when you're in those groups. And when you're in the breakout rooms, to use those guidelines of no fixing, no saving, no advising, no setting each other straight, to remember those guidelines. And again, in a sense, when you go into breakout rooms, it is kind of a laissez-faire thing. you go into that breakout room, you don't have a leader yet. And if there's only two of you, you know, you can work things out between the two of you. But sometimes if you have a larger group, you're going to see somebody come forth and kind of take the leadership most of the time in these groups. And so I really want you to think about these group dynamics and creating safety anytime we go into breakout rooms. So I'm glad you brought that up, Bliss. The storyteller. You ever been in a group with the storyteller who tells they contribute irrelevant tales of woe most of the time? But there will be people in groups who are just, in a sense, totally disconnected from whatever the group purpose is. And they're so engrossed in their own story that it might have nothing to do with the topic at hand, but they'll go on and on and on. And so that's another one that, as a leader, you have to learn, how do I pull this person back into the group and help them to engage appropriately? And sometimes it's a pretty simple thing of going, okay, Jane, that's a little off topic right now. We want to let's turn back and focus on this right now.
And with the priority being showing honor as we do that, and even redirecting in the form of a question sometimes to that person to help get back on track, right?
Yes, yes. Yeah, so you might help them to continue talking, but maybe in a different direction to refocus them so that whatever they're sharing is relevant to the group. This is one of the challenges we've had often in our Wednesday morning group, because it's just a general come one, come all. And so there's not one specific topic, but you will get people who just want to go on and on and on and on and on about their story. And so sometimes you can, if you know that you've got people like this in a group, you can say, okay, we have 20 minutes now, and I want to let each of you have about 5 minutes to share. And so I'm going to let you know when your time is up. And so you warn them ahead of time so that they're not offended when you say, okay, you need to close now. We've still got three more people to share. So often it helps to lay out guidelines ahead of time.
I was just going to say, establishing those group rules.
Yes.
And holding each other accountable.
Uh-huh. And that's what's helpful when the group helps create the rules.
Yep. Absolutely. You know? Yeah.
Because then they can help keep each other accountable.
Yeah. Also too, I just wanted to bring something up about people that want to continually talk about, you know, their story and they get off topic. Oftentimes I would say, like, you know, we need to stick to the topic on hand, but I really appreciate, you know, you sharing, mm-hmm. but maybe after group is over, you know, you could talk to a couple of people and share more that. So
yeah, good example. Thanks. You might also have a social isolate. So that's what we often refer to as the wallflower. It's a person that can come into a group and you would never know they were there. They could like disappear. And it's interesting because they're sitting there physically, and yet even as a leader, you can lose connection with them because they're so drawn inside that there's no energy there to connect to, you know, that they've purposely gone into this black hole where you can't find them. My husband is one of those people. He's funny because he will be out in public. He can talk to anybody. he can bring up a conversation with anybody in the checkout line, you know, but you get him into a group and he can totally disappear. Never say a word. You wouldn't even know he was in the group. He's very skilled at it. But it takes skill in leadership to recognize that, you know, and this is a huge challenge on Zoom. Right now, I can see 1, 2, 3, 4. I can see 5 of you because I put this on speaker so that we can record it. And so I can't see what's going on with most of you. And for a number of you, you have to have your cameras off. And so it's easy to become that social isolate or the wallflower in a Zoom group because I can just shut my camera and microphone off and disappear. And then the last one that I have listed, and this, you know, you can probably make up others to add to this list, but the last one I have on here identified is the harmonizer. So this is the person that's going to try to smooth everything over, make sure that there's no conflict, that nobody is upset with somebody else, or, you know, try to help everybody have a common opinion so that there's no discomfort in the group. Okay, so those were 8 different group roles that I identified. Anybody have one that you need to add to it or comments on some that we talked about?
Interrogator.
The antagonizer, yeah, that could kind of go along with the interrogator, but yeah, there are group, I think there's people that just deliberately upset groups. They like to create the chaos and the conflict. There was one of you, I think it was Rial maybe, that was sharing about somebody that there was just argument and disagreement in the group and somebody had to be right all the time. Not good.
What do you do with the people that disappear in the group? How do you make them appear again?
That's where you kind of have to call them out and say, Osborne, what do you think about this? What are your thoughts? And so I think you want to be gentle and maybe not, you want to make sure it's a question that there's no wrong answers. It's their thought, it's their opinion, it's their idea. And encouraging them to let them know that their voice is important, that we really want to hear from you.
Thank you.
Is that how you would do it, Osborne? You've led a few groups.
Yeah. You keep on calling them, and the more you call them, the more they go under the table, the more at times.
Yeah.
Because it's their personality. That's how they live. They the more you call them, the more they push farther rather than coming closer.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So I wanted to know. Yeah.
Anybody else got an idea?
So the interesting thing, the person I shared about at the beginning, that my best friend, when I met her 16 years ago, she was exactly who Osborne just described. And I began a personal relationship of discipling and just calling her out and calling her to her strengths. And now 16 years later, she is the one calling people out and voicing and having a very leadership role. So I would say sometimes they have to feel safe in any relationship to go to that next level with a one-on-one. And then even it might begin to expand in other areas or aspects like a group.
Mm-hmm. I think sometimes too, if there's the opportunity for some personal attention, you know, that you would deliberately sit by that person in the group. And of course, depending on the relationship and the group and stuff, we're GSM, so we're kind of a touchy-feely group. That, you know, that I've often sat by somebody and will like put my hand on their knee or reach over and touch their hand or their shoulder or something that just kind of engages their energy with me and helps them to maybe feel some more safety.
Can I share an example with that?
Yeah.
Okay. So a lot of times, you know, like if there was those types of group members who, you know, were, you know, that would disappear quiet. I would do this little thing where I would say, so what we're going to do is we're going to do this exercise where you turn to the person on your right.
Mm-hmm.
And you tell them something that you really admire about them. And so sometimes that will kind of build, you know, those group members up that like to disappear.
Yeah, yeah. I'm glad you brought that up. That's called icebreakers.
Yeah.
That it's especially, you know, in groups like this, we're together long enough that we don't need icebreakers as much anymore. But we did some of that in the very beginning.
Yeah.
So it's like, this is where you would go around, an example of where you might go around the circle and say, okay, I want each person to share your name and the reason that you're here, or, you know, one thing about yourself that you think others don't know, or like you say, turn to the person next to you. There's all kinds of fun icebreakers. Yeah. You can just Google it and get a bunch of really good ideas too. Yeah.
And then sometimes you can say, you know, to name or say something to the person on your right that you admire about them, and then what you feel they need to work on.
Mm,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. I've done some where it's like you pair up with somebody and you ask them a few questions, or maybe you have some specific questions, but then they introduce each other. And so in a sense, you're putting them into a position where they're obligated to talk or to use their voice in the group. And so there's some groups where, you know, say if I'm in a group that's dealing with profound grief of some type, I'm not necessarily going to put people in a position in that group where they have to speak. That this might be a group where it's like, you are free to speak or not speak. And they may come for 3 weeks and not say a word. And then the fourth week they feel safe enough to be able to speak because they feel so vulnerable over the loss that they're dealing with. In this class, in a counseling class, it's all about pushing your comfort zones and getting you outside the box. And so I don't really worry about offending people a whole lot. You're here
it's
because
always our choice to pick up an offense or not. We always get to choose.
Yeah.
Not saying it's wise to choose, but we can choose if we're going to be offended that you put us on the spot.
Mm-hmm. But not all groups know that when you start.
I had a group.
Go ahead, Diane.
Sorry. I had a group at my house today, and we have one lady that doesn't share a lot. But today she did open up and share more. And I just sent her a text tonight thanking her for sharing and just telling her how valuable she was to our group, hoping to encourage her and that she'll share more in the future.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a great example. Yes, that when you get that social isolate or the wallflower, you want to encourage them anytime you hear their voice. Yeah. Okay, so the last piece I had here was on group development. You know, as human beings, we go through developmental stages, and we'll be learning more about that next year in level 2. But groups have developmental stages. And especially if you're, this is about talking more about a closed group than it would be an open group. So we are an example of, I would call us semi-closed because I do allow people to come in at different stages, but at the same time, this isn't just like come and go as you please. It's like you make a commitment. You're part of this class, you're part of this training, and we need you. and so you will see that a closed group will go through some developmental stages. And in the beginning, it's dealing with approach and avoidance behaviors. The members of the group are concerned about fitting in, and so maybe hesitant to speak up or speaking up a lot because out of nervousness. And so just kind of testing the waters. You're finding the boundaries of the group and your comfort level of joining in and giving your thoughts or opinions in the group. And you might be, maybe you know some other people in the group and you're concerned about what, oh gosh, I know them and what do they think of me, or maybe I'm judging them. But you almost always have in a group of new people, even you're looking at everybody else and you're wondering what they're thinking of you. And so that's the very first or beginning stage of a group is just that approach avoidance, concerned about fitting in, being accepted. The second stage would be conflict. That you may be in a group where, man, there's a personality here that I don't like. Or somebody said something that offended me.
I've been in groups with teenagers where they flat out said, like, attacking things. Like, oh, that was so stupid. Why would you say that? Mm-hmm. And having to redirect it to a positive and bring it back to a safe spot is not always easy, especially when you have young teenagers.
Yeah. And the thing that's key is resolving the conflict. That as the group leader, if you are in a position where you're aware of some conflict that's going on, and you may be in a group where you need to voice it to the group that if you have conflict or concern, we got somebody unmuted here. You may need to voice to your group that if you do have a conflict or concern with another person, I want you to come either, you know, you help them learn how to work it out. You may facilitate that. You may give them some instruction on how to approach this other person and to deal with it. But part of the group is conflict resolution, and you don't want to run away from it. And as a group leader, expect it and don't be afraid of it. Because this is a healthy part of our developmental growth, is working through conflict. Because a lot of times they're in the group because they didn't learn conflict resolution at home. And so this group can become that safe family where it's okay to have differences. And we can learn to work it out. And that doesn't mean that I'm going to cuddle up to you in the next group and like you. But it means I'm willing to hear you. I'm willing to create a safe place for you to be who you are. And we often come into group with, I think it was like what Stephen was sharing. We come in with prejudgments of what we think other people think. Or we may judge somebody by their status or where they live or how much money they make or don't make or their education or lack of education or their experience or lack of experience in something. And so part of the group development is learning to meet everybody wherever they're at and learn to love and accept them as they are, learning that their opinion, their voice, their life is valuable. And being able to express that in the group experience. So you're not going to come into the group necessarily with that mentality, or you're going to have a number of people in the group that don't get it. And sometimes people will leave the group. And if they do, as the leader, you want to check in with them and try to learn what, you know, the reason they left, what's going on here. And they may or may not return, but that's not your responsibility. Your responsibility is to love and accept them where they're at. And sometimes it's just the timing. Maybe they came in and they sat in a few classes and went, whoa, this is not for me, I'm not ready. And that might be okay. So stage one, approach and avoidance. Stage two, conflict and conflict resolution. Or I guess stage three is actually the resolution, developing a cohesiveness, that family, problem solving together, learning to work with each other. And then the final stage of group development would be termination, separation, breaking away. And that is also a necessary part of the group development, that you can't stay a group forever. You know, that even in our family systems, yes, we are a family for eternity, but on the one hand, we grow up and leave home and we go start our own families, or we go out and pursue something else besides our childhood. And so it's healthy to go through these things and normal, and don't be afraid of it as a group leader. So that is really all the information that I have. I would like to hear from some of you that haven't spoken yet. What did you hear tonight that was important to you, or this morning? Or what input, maybe questions? We have about 10 minutes that we can use to close here tonight. Are there some of you here that have never led a group? I'd like to hear from somebody who maybe has never led a group and what your thoughts on trying it are.
Thank you, Cindy, for this lovely lesson for us. And actually, it's really important lesson for me. I used to lead other groups, small groups and big groups, but that was the long, long, many years ago. And I almost forget about how I lead them. But I saw that, you know, during the you told us how to balance the group, and also there is the 8 different kind of attendance in our group, which is really important for me, because I'm just thinking about it, who am I at the moment in this group, which was the, my first thought, and then who I will be in the other group next time, you know, and how I have to change my method. Just a moment. Sorry, everyone, there is a lot of noise.
It's okay.
Yeah, and I'm just thinking about who I am in next time, which is the really important part of me, because I'm quite a shy person in the big group. If I knew people more than before, I'm quite an open person, actually. And also, I'm just really enjoyed or really happy to see that stage of group, and which is also helpful for me to lead next time, because at the moment I'm in Mongolia at the moment. But before New Year, I was in Australia. I had a big decision to come back into Mongolia. And at the moment, I don't have any job. I'm thinking about what I'm going to do. And I am asking, still praying about it. And sometimes it's really nice. It's every time, it's my emotion is depends on each day, you know, sometimes up and sometimes down. And I'm thinking about what I'm going to do in here. And maybe is there some possibility to working, you know? I believe that God called me in here, but I don't know what for, you know? Do I really need it here or not? Because when I see some people who is surrounding me, who is really good capacity or good skills than me, what should I do here, you know? And then I thought just giving up in front of God and asking about what I'm going to do. And but when I listened this, when I attended this class, I thought, oh, it's so good to be a good standing in the group, first of all. And then I need to see what what I'm going to do next time, which was the quite concerning lesson for me.
Great.
I'm still thinking, and I'm thankful for attending this lovely training, you know. Yeah. Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you for being so vulnerable and open, Sigi. I'm going to take a minute and pray for you before we move on to the next person, yes, okay?
Please. Yes, please.
Father, we thank you that somehow Sigi found us and that she is a part of this group. And we are blessed by that, Lord. And we see the changes transpiring in her life already, just with her move from Australia back to Mongolia. And we know, Lord, that you orchestrated that. You went before her. You made the arrangements, and that you will not leave her or forsake her. So we thank you, Lord, that you have a purpose and a plan and a direction for Sigi, and that you will unfold that to her, that she will know the direction that you will have her go. Even if it's scary or uncomfortable, that you will be with her, that you will guide her, and that you will bless her, because you do have a plan for her life. So we just thank you that part of that plan includes us, and we thank you that she is in this group. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Stephen, do you have your hand raised, or somebody in your group?
Yeah, I'm Francis.
Okay, hi, Francis.
Andeka. Nice to see you, Madam Cindy. And I thank God for today's teaching, because it has been our for helping us to
Your sound is breaking. We interact with.
Okay. I've said that I have a challenge with the groups that we interact with. Sometimes you find somebody has a client, but he doesn't.
You might have to shut your video off. Your sound is breaking up. Your sound is breaking up. So Francis,
sometimes you find
you might have to shut your video off. The sound is breaking up. We can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I was trying to say that to ask that sometime you meet a client who is talkative. How can you be helped, or how can you help me if somebody cannot, is too much talkative? He doesn't want to listen, doesn't want to you to speak with him or her. How can you help me to know to handle that issue?
So this goes back to what we've been learning primarily when we were doing the life history case studies, in that you learn to ask the questions rather than giving them answers. And you can see Jesus model this, that Jesus was always rather, you know, somebody would ask him a question and he would return with a question. And that often when people come to us and they want us to give them the answers, they want us to tell them what to do or how to fix something, that's where we have to be praying and asking the Lord, okay, Lord, what is the question? What can I ask them that will help them discover the answer for themselves? Rather than me or somebody else telling them what to do. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. Thank you.
And there's no, you know, there's no formula from it. There's no set of, here's the questions you ask. It really is listening to the Holy Spirit and practicing at all times. Lord, what is the question? What do I need to ask them that will help them discover? And I may even have an answer for them. I may have an idea of what they need and what I would like to tell them. But I always say, if you know the answer, what is the question to the answer?
Okay.
So practice with each other in your group. Asking the questions.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. I was looking at the chat. Leslie said she had to go to help get a grandson ready for bed. And Joseph wrote in a chat, thank you so very much. I've been moved today by the difference between me and the other people. I mean, the difference between a counselor and advisors. Interrogators and many more. Now I know what to put out, where and when. I'm really so grateful and bless you, Mama. So Joseph, is there anything else you wanted to say? Thank you for that message. Okay, so we are at the end of our time. Is there somebody who feels led to close us in prayer tonight?
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for such an opportunity to extend an invitation to us to come and sit at thy feet and receive from thy throne. Mm-hmm. You've taught us so much. You are empowering us. You're helping us to develop and be energized that you may reach out and launch in the deep. Thank you for your servant, Mama Cindy, for the grace you've given her as a leader, and to be led by your Holy Spirit to guide the class and the group. Thank you, Lord, and help us that whatsoever we've learned, we will put it into practice. Yes. And I pray that the Holy Spirit, you may even continue where the class has ended today. As we all depart, may you be with us until we meet again. Yes. In Jesus' mighty name.
Amen.
Amen and amen.
Amen.
And look forward to seeing you again next week. And tomorrow I'm going to have a little time to work on probably some of your emails and homework that I haven't got to for a few days. So, Sigi, is this your daughter?
Yes, here is my daughter.
Hi. Welcome to your mom's class.
Thank you.
And what is your name?
Oh, just a moment.
My name is Achima.
Achima, welcome. Glad to meet you.
Hello, can you hear us?
Yeah.
My name is Achima.
She's 8 years old.
All right.
Yeah. Okay, it's nice to see you, everyone. Have a good evening. Thank you, Sandy.
Good night or good morning.
Good night.
Okay.
And good night and good morning to others. Have a good day or a good night's sleep.
Thank you. Yeah,
have a good
thank
night,
you, Mama.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
God bless you. Stephen, I see.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Cindy.
Yes. I see Moses there with you.
Good morning, Aryuna. Have a good day.
What time in Mongolia right now? Here it is 7. Yeah, in Uganda, it is 7:30 a.m. What time in Mongolia right now?
It's 12:37 p.m. It's after 12:30, sorry, a.m. p.m. in the morning, in the afternoon, sorry.
Yeah, no time. 5 hours different. Yeah. Okay, nice to meet you and God bless you. Love you.
God bless. You. Thank you.
It's a privilege to know you.
Welcome. Thank you for teaching.
Mm-hmm. You're very welcome. I love being here.
Amen.
Thank you, Cindy. Good night.
Uh-huh. Good night, Diane. Good night. Thanks for sharing.
Okay, good night. Bye.
Good night, Cindy.
Yeah, bye. Thank you.
Good night, John and Esther.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna hit the end button.
Right, so open that button.